Good morning, everyone. Welcome to our virtual informal system seminar. It's my great pleasure to introduce to you our speaker today, Kai Cui. Mr. Kai Cui is a PhD candidate at the Bio-Inspired Communication Systems Lab under the supervision of Professor Hans Kappel at the Technical University of Darmstadt, Germany. Prior to joining BCS, he also received the BSc and the MSc degrees in computer science, as well as electrical engineering and information technology at the Technical University of Darmstadt. His current research interests are multi-agent systems, reinforcement learning, and mean field games and UAV swarms. His talk today, as you can see, is on the interesting topic on approximately solving mean field games where entropy regularized deep reinforcement learning. Without further ado, let's welcome Mr. Kai Cui. Kai, the floor is yours.
Thank you. Thank you for the nice introduction. I'm honored to be here today. And today I will be presenting our most recent work on solving entropy regularized mean field games, as you can see in the title. So this is to appear at AI Stats 2021. And this work is basically located in between the following three ideas, which are mean field models, which lend tractability to a large scale systems, reinforcement learning, which is a sample-based solution of optimal control problems, and also game theory, which deals with multiple agents and the solution concepts for multi-agent systems. So first of all, maybe we should talk about why is it even interesting to think about learning in mean field games at all. And basically in the real world, there are lots of multi-agent scenarios you can think of. For example, I have two pictures here, which are auctions and vaccination. And in all of these scenarios, typically what we have are independent, rational, and self-interested agents. And therefore it would perhaps be interesting to predict in these scenarios, such as auctions and vaccination, how would such self-interested agents, such as human beings, act in such a scenario. And in that case, a common solution concept that is adopted is the Nash equilibrium from game theory. And it would be great to, for example, just make a model and then use learning to find the Nash equilibrium computationally. Now, unfortunately, there is a big problem with that, because typically finding a Nash equilibrium computationally is very hard, except in certain special cases. And one of those special cases are exactly the mean field games. So in a mean field game, what we basically do is we assume that there are lots of agents n to infinity, which are all homogeneous and competitive. And we assume that the interaction between the agents is only via their state action distribution, for example. And by assuming this weak interaction, we get that the Nash equilibrium becomes the perhaps more tractable mean field equilibrium. And the good thing about this mean field equilibrium is that in the finite n game, it will constitute an epsilon n Nash equilibrium, approximate Nash equilibrium, where the approximation gets increasingly good as n grows. So epsilon n goes to zero as n to infinity. And now, still, it is unclear how to find these more tractable mean field equilibria. And so far, what you could do is you could consider special cases. In those cases, you may find analytic solutions. But also what you could do is you could use one of these two computational methods, fixed point iteration or fictitious play. But the problem still with these two methods is that they require certain conditions to hold such that they converge to the mean field equilibrium. For example, fixed point iteration requires contractivity, whereas fictitious play requires, for example, monotonicity. So let us begin with the N-agent formulation of the game. We begin by formulating N agents with the state and action spaces S and A. And each of these agents will have random variables, STI and ATI, valued in S and A at every time step T in a finite time horizon. So we only consider times from 0 to capital T, and also everything shall be in discrete time. Now, what we can define is the empirical measure of states, GSN, which is basically just the histogram of states. So how often does a certain state appear in an agent? And then each agent chooses a Markov policy, pi I, which is basically telling the agent how should the agent act depending on its own local state. And it will give, depending on the local state in S, a distribution over actions in P of A. So for simplicity, this is assumed to map from S to P of A instead of S to the N to P of A, because essentially, if you think about it, since all the interactions in the following will be only via the empirical measure of states, it doesn't matter what the other agents have, because this empirical measure will turn out to be deterministic. So therefore, it is sufficient to consider such Markov policies. Right, so the random variables will follow some initial distribution mu zero, the states, and then after that, the actions will be sampled from this policy, and then the next state will be sampled depending on the current state, the action that was taken by the agent, and then depending also on the empirical measure of agent states. And then finally, the goal of agents is to maximize some expected sum of reward, where the rewards again depend on exactly the same things as the transition kernel. Okay, so now here we can define the concept of optimality for this multi-agent problem. And what we choose to do is we define the approximate Markov-Nash equilibrium, which is essentially just a tuple of policies such that no single agent can gain more than epsilon, where epsilon is some positive real number, and epsilon, if epsilon is zero, basically we really have a Nash equilibrium, but for epsilon greater zero, we just have an approximate Nash equilibrium. Right. And what we can do now is we can just let n go to infinity. And as a result, we will obtain just a single representative agent living in a Markov decision process, coupled with a deterministic mean field mu, which will be replacing this previously random empirical distribution of states. So everything will just stay as before. And now we can define new random variables for this single agent under this mean field mu. And so these random variables will, for some fixed mean field mu, follow basically exactly the same as the previous laws, except for we replace the empirical distribution with the mean field, which is deterministic. And then on the other hand, if we have a fixed policy, which is to be followed by, so to speak, all the other agents, other than the representative agent, we get an induced mean field by this evolution equation. And now we can define the mean field equilibrium, which is the counterpart to the Nash equilibrium we saw earlier. So let us define these two maps here. One is the set valued map phi hat, which maps from mean fields to all of the optimal policies, right? So there could be multiple optimal policies in an MDP, therefore we map to a set. And then the other map is the single-valued map psi, which maps from a policy to its induced mean field via its evolution equation, which can be seen here. And the mean field equilibrium now is simply a pair of policies and mean fields, pi mu, such that pi is exactly in phi hat of mu, and mu, on the other hand, is generated by pi. And the good thing about this mean field equilibrium, again, is that at least in our case, if we have finite S and A, as long as R and P, so the reward function and the transition kernel, are continuous, then there always exists at least one mean field equilibrium. And further, as mentioned before already, as n goes to infinity, it will be an epsilon Markov Nash equilibrium in the n agent game with epsilon to zero. So therefore, the MFE is a good approximate Nash equilibrium if we have sufficiently many agents. So why does this work? The proof sketch is basically as follows. For finite spaces, the existence follows immediately from Kakutani's fixed point theorem, and the approximate Nash property can be shown in a few steps, which has been shown by Zaldi in this way, Zaldi et al. Basically, what we consider is some policies pi n in the mean field game, and then this policy tuple pi n comma pi, so pi is followed by all the other agents except the first agent. And then we consider the mean field generated by the policy that is followed by all the other agents. In that case, it can be shown that the empirical distribution of states converges to the deterministic mean field at all times in L1. You can just do this by induction. And then similarly, you just do this for the law of the state distribution of this first agent. And you do the same thing for the joint law as well. And then you finally get that since the objectives are sum over such terms, that basically the objective of the n agent game will be close to the objective of the mean field game. Right. So how do we find these solutions computationally now? Well, we can do fixed point iteration, which is a really simple method to do this. So far, we had a set valued map and a single valued map. But now what we need is we need some single valued map phi, which now maps from a mean field to some optimal policy. We just choose some kind of single valued map in some way. And then what we could think of is we could just iterate this composition phi of psi of pi, right? And if we have a fixed point of this composition, then we have an MFE, right? And we can do this either by doing phi of psi of pi, or we could do it the other way around, psi of phi of mu. And it is known that this will converge if this composition is Lipschitz continuous with a constant smaller than one. But unfortunately, there also lies the problem, because clearly this is not always going to hold. And actually what we can find is that in finite mean field games, usually this is not going to hold. Because if you look at a non-trivial problem, you can have the following theorem. Let's say the image of phi is a finite set, which is actually the case for example, putting equal mass on all optimal actions, because we have a finite horizon and finite state and action spaces. Or you could pick the first optimal action in some sorted order. It doesn't matter. It will usually be from a finite set. Then basically you have the following result, that the composition will either be constant or it will not be Lipschitz continuous and therefore not contractive. And the proof is pretty simple. So basically, you consider some pi in this finite set pi of phi. And then you basically think about what is the inverse image of gamma of pi. How does it look like? And it will be some region, right? And if gamma was continuous, then basically by finiteness of such regions, the values must be equal everywhere, because otherwise it will suddenly jump. So this is why exact fixed point iterations cannot work in the general case. And now another method is fictitious play, which actually has game theoretic roots from classical economical game theory as early as 1951. And there it was used to find Nash equilibria in, for example, two-player zero-sum games or potential games. And fictitious play works by computing the best response to the average of the past best responses. And we start at some arbitrary policy. And actually, this has also been adapted to mean field games as well. So for example, this can be applied to continuous time potential mean field games, again, under the typical monotonicity condition, where you assume that basically agents prefer to be in states where there are less other agents. And similarly, you can apply this also in discrete time potential mean field games. But again, there are no convergence guarantees for non-monotone problems, right? Because you need these conditions to hold, and they in general will not hold. So therefore, we again want a different approach. Let's quickly consider a simple toy example. Let's say you have many agents that choose between two sides, and then the side with more people in it is punished by the difference between both sides. Well, the solution is going to be that everyone picks uniformly at random, right? Because then it's going to be 50-50. But the problem here is that naive fixed point iteration will fail, because except if you exactly start at 50-50 and choose to exactly pick this 50-50 policy for some reason, because as soon as you don't have 50-50, the people that are on the side with more people will try to choose the one with less people, and then this will just oscillate. In this case, fictitious play does work because we do have a monotone game, but in certain other cases we will see later, it will also not work. And then our approach is basically approximating the mean field game by using entropy regularization, and this will help the fixed point iteration to converge. And in this way, we can obtain approximate mean field equilibria. So what we do basically is we empirically combine entropy regularization with fictitious play, also sample-based algorithms, and then prior descent, we'll see it later, to obtain good approximate Nash equilibria. Right, let's have a brief introduction into reinforcement learning. So reinforcement learning is basically approximate sample-based optimal control, and it can be used to solve MDPs on the left here in a black box manner, right? So basically we can use reinforcement learning to solve pi equal phi of mu, right? It's basically this phi operator here. And empirically, it turns out that you can also just generalize this to multiple agents, for example, to partially observable Markov games and whatever lies in between. However, the theoretical guarantees are very sparse, and there are also some problems left, such as credit assignment or curse of dimensionality. And here, such mean field models could be really great. And so in reinforcement learning, it is actually known that you can do this relative entropy stuff. It is quite well known, actually. So you can do relative entropy reinforcement learning which can, for example, be obtained by doing RL via inference. And what is very common is that you simply use a uniform prior, which will then be called maximum entropy RL. And all that you really do is that you simply add a relative entropy term to the reward, such as here. Right, so this leads actually to quite state-of-the-art algorithms, such as soft actor critic, and will provide robustness, which can also be shown. So robustness, for example, against some perturbations of reward functions or dynamics. And so we use this and simply apply it to mean field games. So what we do now is we change our objective to the following, right? So we had this sum over rewards before, but now the new term on the right is this minus eta log pi over q, right? And basically what this boils down to is the KL divergence between pi and q. So we are trying to also minimize the KL divergence between those two at the same time. So the result is that the optimal policy that is unique will be given as follows. You can get it by simply normalizing the product of the prior probabilities of actions times this energy function here, where the energy is given by the soft action value function. So the soft action value function, this is given by the soft maximum Bellman recursion. And so basically what happens here is instead of using the usual maximum in the usual Bellman recursion or Bellman equation, you will use this soft maximum eta log sum exp. And that's it. And then you get this q tilde. And so using this new type of solution, we can, of course, define now a relative entropy MFE operator, so a fixed point operator, by simply selecting the policy exactly according to the optimal policy we just saw. And then in this way, we can define the relative entropy mean field equilibrium simply as a fixed point of the composition of this policy selection and the mean field map. And in the same way, we can call it an eta xand MFE if we use the uniform prior policy. We just call it maxand then. Okay, so if we consider this fixed point iteration now, the nice result is that if we also assume that R and P are now additionally Lipschitz continuous, that these relative entropy mean field equilibria will always exist, of course, but also as eta goes to infinity, they will be guaranteed to be contractive. So basically we will be able to find them using simple fixed point iteration as long as we choose the temperature that is high enough. But then on the other hand, if we let eta small enough, so eta to zero, and then also the number of agents to infinity, then again, we have an epsilon Markov-Nash equilibrium in the n agent game by choosing this relative entropy mean field equilibrium with epsilon again going to zero. Right. And now we can do one more modification actually by noticing that actually the energy-based policy is the important part. Actually, we don't need to use this soft maximum action value function. What we can use instead is we just simply use the usual Q function. In that case, we simply insert instead of Q tilde previously, the Q star, which is the usual action value function from the usual Bellman equation. And then you can, of course, define the same as before. You can define Boltzmann mean field equilibria as the fixed point by choosing policies like this. And this will have exactly the same properties as relative entropy mean field equilibria. Okay, so for the proof sketch, it's actually pretty simple. So the existence just follows directly from Brouwer's fixed point theorem. And the contractivity is also relatively straightforward because, well, Q and Q tilde are just finite recursive sums of Lipschitz continuous functions, right? And the softmax policy function, which is given here in the middle, will turn out to be Lipschitz with the Lipschitz constant that scales with 1 over eta, so 1 over the temperature. And therefore, if we let the temperature go to infinity, eventually it will be smaller than 1. And then finally, the approximate Nash property will follow by first introducing the policy value function. Basically, it is the same as the action value function, except the maximum, we replace it by the policy evaluation itself. And then we can show that the policy value of a policy phi eta of mu will actually converge to the actual usual Bellman equation, so the optimal action value function, uniformly as eta to zero. So therefore, as eta goes to zero for some eta relative entropy mean field equilibrium, we will have the result that the policy pi star of this mean field equilibrium will be near optimal under the mean field of the mean field equilibrium, mu star. And the rest will follow from the proof of previous theorems. Okay, so what is the relation to prior and concurrent works? If you have read these other works from Anataki et al. And Guo et al., we have a few differences. So Anataki et al. Consider Q learning in stationary regularized MFGs. And in contrast, now we consider a non-stationary case in a finite horizon, although you could also just extend the formulation to infinite horizons. We add some suboptimality analysis for unregularized games as eta goes to zero. And we also show that the contractivity is guaranteed as eta goes to infinity. Right. And then furthermore, we add some empirical evaluation and propose the Boltzmann policies as seen before and the prior iteration as seen later. And then there is also the work of Guo et al., which propose entropy regularized mean field games, but in a LQ SDE setting, so in a continuous time setting actually. And as opposed to that, we live in a discrete time model. Right. So let's get to the algorithms actually. What you can see here is just the usual algorithm without relative entropy or Boltzmann policies. So what we do here is we simply initialize with some mean field mu zero. And then to do fixed point iteration, we simply compute the Q function and then choose some policy such that this policy will be optimal. And if we want to do fictitious play as well, then basically all we add is we add these two steps here, where the first step is to overwrite the new policy with the average over the past policies. And then after that, we compute the new mean field. And then again, we also, if we want to use fictitious play, substitute it by using the average over all the past ones. And then all we really need to change to arrive at Boltzmann or relative entropy iteration is to simply change the choice of policy by using this softmax policy as described before. And then depending on if you want to do Boltzmann or relative entropy iteration, we use the Q function or the soft Q function. Okay, so now we can get to the experiments. And first, let us define some metric according to which we can actually evaluate the quality of our achieved equilibria. And for this, we define the exploitability. So the exploitability delta J of a policy pi is given as the amount you can win. So the amount you can get better by choosing a different policy, pi star, in the mean field induced by pi. So clearly, if this exploitability is zero, actually pi will produce a mean field equilibrium by taking pi and the mean field generated by pi. So this exploitability will translate directly into the limiting equilibrium quality in finite n games. And therefore, it is perhaps a good idea to use this as an evaluation metric. And now, what do we evaluate on? So we introduce these four problems here. One of them is LR, which is basically the toy example from before, except that we also add some multiplier to left side or right side. Then there is rock, paper, scissors, which is a modified non-zero sum rock, paper, scissors from Shapley from 1964, which was shown to, it was shown that FP, so fictitious play, does not converge in this case. Then there's the SIS example, which we will see on the next slide, and then also a taxi example, which will be infeasible because the state space is really large, where we should use perhaps reinforcement learning. Okay, so since we are going to look a bit more into this SIX example, let us actually talk about what it is. So the SIS example is basically a game of epidemics where people can choose to socially distance D or go out U. And the idea is that socially distancing avoids potential infections I. And if people instead go out, then they will have a chance of getting infected with a probability that is proportional to the currently number of currently infected agents. And when you are infected, then you will recover back to susceptible, so healthy, S, with a fixed chance at every time step. And now we simply add costs to both social distancing and being infected. And if you choose the right parameters, then it will turn out that you will have the situation where everyone choosing D will be suboptimal, because if everyone chooses D, then the disease disappears. And then, of course, U becomes optimal for a single agent. And the same thing holds the other way around. So the result will be that there is a stochastic equilibrium. Right, now we can show the experimental results. And so this graph requires perhaps some explanation. But first of all, it is nice to note that our setting allows exact computation. So indeed, these plots are all completely deterministic. And what you can see here is on the x-axis, you can see the temperature we chose. And then on the y-axis, you can see the achieved exploitability. So actually, you can see the achieved mean exploitability over the final 10 iterations of the fixed point iteration. And as the straight through line. And then you can also see as a shaded region and with dashed lines, the maximum and minimum exploitability over the final 10 iterations. So what this means is that for some fixed temperature eta, basically we can see from the size of the shaded region whether we are converging or not. And what we can see here basically is that, well, as we increase the temperatures, then eventually there will be a point that, as the theory predicts, the fixed point iteration will converge actually. right? So there is no shaded region, for example, starting from 0.75 on the left plot. And so the nice thing now is that for some choice eta that is greater than zero, because for eta equals zero, we have exact fixed point iteration, we can actually achieve better exploitability than otherwise possible, right? And for example, for the SIS example, it's very prominent that at 0.07, you get a really good result, whereas otherwise you will not get a good result. Okay, and you can also plot the convergence of the exploitability on the left, or also the mean field on the right. And you can see that if you choose the temperature sufficiently large, then it will converge faster and faster. Whereas if you choose the temperature too low so that it doesn't converge yet, then you will see, for example, in the red line, that we will run into a limit cycle. And also a nice thing to note is that the theory guarantees convergence for eta greater one in LR. Empirically, we already have convergence for eta greater equals 0.7. Right, so now we can look at the SIS example a bit more into detail. And we can actually see intuitive results. On the left, you can see the result for Boltzmann iteration with a temperature of eta equals 0.07. In the middle, you can see the result of exact fixed point iteration. And on the right, you can see the result for fictitious play, averaging both policy and mean field. Right, and what you can see basically is that our result will be intuitive in the sense that you can see that just a fraction of people will be choosing social distancing, at which point it doesn't make a difference anymore if we choose social distancing or not. And then at the end, nobody cares anymore because the game will end at time t equal 50. So there is no social distancing anymore. And the other solutions, you can see that they will oscillate between always choosing social distancing or not at all. And yeah, so if you change the parameters, more iterations, or only use average policies or average mean fields instead of both, the same will happen. Okay, and finally, you can also apply sample-based solutions, so reinforcement learning. So if we do everything on a sample-based manner, then basically we introduce randomness. So now the plots are actually random. And the randomness comes from one, the sample-based solution, so RL, but also from the particle-based mean field. So we simply simulate using particles the mean field. And also from random evaluation of this exploitability. So basically, we see here that qualitatively the curves are similar in LR and SIS as to the previous ones. But in TAXI, this solution does not appear to improve as we increase the temperature. And basically, even though the MDP is actually adequately solved by the reinforcement learning method, there are some problems because, well, one, we have maybe too few iterations because it's really costly. And the other thing is that the uniform prior is really bad. So finally, what we could do is, this is completely empirical, of course, we could just use a prior, get a solution, and then use this solution and insert it again as a prior. So this could work, right? But actually there are no guarantees of convergence. And also if you just continue doing this for a fixed temperature, it will not work. So what we do is we just use some temperature heuristic where we let the temperature go up fast enough so that we eventually converge. So we just test these six values, for example, and we can see that for some value, we can actually get an even better result than previously possible in SIS. Okay, so to conclude, basically the current methods cannot handle the general case. Therefore, we proposed to use entropy regularization as an approximation to mean field gains. And we find that this works and demonstrate theoretical findings empirically. So possible future work includes further investigations into this prior descent method, potential extensions to common noise, stochastic mean fields, and so on, or perhaps an application to interesting problems. Okay, that's it. I thank you for your attention. And if you have any questions, please go ahead.